Having a brief idea of some important terms of definition in my first lecture of the topic functions of a complex variable. Now I am going to explore the concept of analytic function. Analytic function, which is also known as monogenic function, holomorphic function. In fact, analytic function's idea is very crucial, and for the beginners it is some troublesome too, but I hope after attending this lecture your all doubts regarding the analytic function will be cleared. So without delay, let us start to explore the idea of analytic function. First of all, I want to define an analytic function at a given point. I have just written the definition for your convenience. The definition of analytic function at a point. Remember, analytic function is defined not only at a point, but it is also defined in a domain, in a region, or as an entire function. But in sequence, we will define each term. First of all, I want to define the analytic function at a particular point. As the definition says, a function f of z, you know, z is a complex variable. You have studied that x plus iy, this combination is in fact z, where x and y are both independent variables, and this z is known as a complex variable, and f is a function of this complex variable z. This function f of z is said to be analytic at a point z naught, a point where z is equal to z naught. This function is said to be analytic when you say that f of z is analytic at z equal to z naught. The definition says f of z will be analytic at the point z equal to z naught only when this function f of z is differentiable not only at z naught, but at every point of some neighborhood of z naught. Let us say this is the point z naught, and our function f is differentiable at this point. But if it is differentiable at this point, it is not a sufficient condition for f of z to be analytic at this point, but we must have other points in close neighborhood of z naught. Let us consider a small disk, and inside this disk there are so many points which is in the neighborhood of z naught. If the function f of z is differentiable at all these points which are in close neighborhood of z naught, in that condition you can say that f of z is analytic at the point z naught. We will give some important examples to clarify this definition, but for time being let us consider a simple example. For illustration, I take an example. Let us take f of z equal to mod of z square. You know what will be mod of z square? Mod of z square is in fact z star, where z star is what? This is complex conjugate of z. As you know, z is x plus iy, so its complex conjugate will be x minus iy, and the product of these two factors will be what? This will be simply x square plus y square. X square plus y square. Is this function differentiable at every point in neighborhood of a certain value of z? In fact, it is found that this function mod of z square is differentiable only at z equal to 0 and at nowhere except z equal to 0, this function z is mod of z square is differentiable. So you can say mod of z square, this is in fact differentiable only at z equal to 0 and nowhere else. So according to the definition, since this function is differentiable only at z equal to 0 and not at all those points which are in the close neighborhood of z equal to 0, so this function is not an analytic function. So mod of z square is not an analytic function. I have not detailed this example, but in course of time, when today's lecture will be ended, you will see I will test by a very intelligent method how this function is not an analytic function. Now, I have just defined f of z as an analytic function at a particular point, but now we will define f of z as an analytic function in a domain. In fact, function f of z is said to be analytic in a domain when it is analytic at every point of the domain. Let us say this is a domain or a region, let us say R. If f of z is analytic at all the points inside this region or inside this domain, in that condition f of z is said to be analytic in this region or in this domain. For convenience, I just write this short statement: a function f of z is analytic. F of z is analytic in a domain or a region R. If it is analytic at every point every point of R. If f of z is analytic at every point of this region R, only then we can say that f of z is analytic in this domain or in this region. What do you mean when I say it is analytic at every point? It means this function is differentiable at every point of this region R. When f of z has a finite derivative, its derivative is not undefined at any point inside this region, then you say that the function is analytic at every point. And if it is analytic at every point of the domain, then it is said to be analytic in that domain. In fact, one thing here we must note that a function f of z which is analytic at some point may not be analytic at some points. In fact, the point where the function f of z ceases to be analytic, it is not analytic, or in other words, if f of z is not differentiable at a particular point, that very point is in fact called singular point of the analytic function. So here is an important term that is called singularity or singular point of f of z. Singular point or singularity. Singularity of f of z. As I have told you, the point where f of z is ceased to be analytic, that very point is called singular point of the function f of z. A point, where f of z ceases to be analytic. That is, when you say it ceases to be analytic, it means it is not analytic at that point. What does it mean? It means that is, f of z is not differentiable at that point. When you say f of z ceases to be analytic at a particular point, then it means f of z is not differentiable at that point. Such a point is called the singular point of f of z, or singularity of f of z, you may say it. We will see later how singularity is found. In fact, in calculus of residues, we will study different type of singularity, isolated singularities, and so on and so on. But here, this is just a reference. When you say that a function f of z, which is analytic at several points, but not analytic at some particular point, those particular points where analyticity does not exist, such points are called singular point of this function. In fact, if you say at a particular point, let us say z naught, this function is not differentiable or analyticity ceases at that point, what does it mean? It means if z equal to z naught is the singular point, of an analytic function, f of z, then in fact what condition will hold? The condition will hold that df dz at z equal to z naught does not exist. If df by dz does not exist at z equal to z naught, then we say that the function f of z is not analytic at z equal to z naught, and such a point z equal to z naught is the singular point of this function. Now we will define a particular function which is called, in fact, entire function, which is most important concept of the analytic function. Most of the analytic functions are in fact entire function. So let us have an idea of entire function. In fact, a function which is analytic everywhere for all z in a complex plane, that is, when you say everywhere, it means modulus of z is less or equal to infinity, in fact not equal to but less than infinity, if the function is analytic in a complex plane everywhere, in that condition such a function is called an entire function. Let us consider a complex plane. Let us consider this is a complex plane, and our function f of z is analytic at all points of this complex plane. In that condition, we say that function f of z is an entire function. In fact, in short, we can define if the function f of z is analytic in the whole of the complex plane, then it is an entire function. For your convenience, I just write this short definition. If the function f of z is analytic in the whole of the complex plane. Whole of the complex plane. When you say whole of the complex plane, it means what? Ki mod of z is less than infinity, we say it, then f of z is said to be an entire function. Said to be an entire function. Further, we will see several examples of entire function, but before citing some examples of analytic function to explain this idea in a clear-cut manner, I would like to introduce three important facts to you. In fact, you have to remember these three important facts which I am giving you before giving some example for illustration of analytic function. Because these three facts will be very helpful to understand the complex idea of analytic function. In fact, remember the word complex. In fact, the idea or the concept of analytic function, or you may say analyticity, is a very crucial condition. We have to see very crucially how we can decide if function is analytic or not, where it is analytic, where it is not analytic, which is its singular point. These things are very crucial. So, in fact, giving the proper example for illustration, I would like to provide you three important facts, and I hope you will always remember these three facts in your mind whenever you study the analyticity or analytic function. The first thing which I would like to state is an entire function, as you have understand what is entire function, a function which is in fact analytic in at all points of a complex plane, that is called entire function. So the first important fact is an entire function is always analytic, differentiable and continuous function. But remember, its converse is not true. A statement of this converse is not true. First, I would like to write down it, and then you will understand it clearly. An entire function is always analytic, always analytic, differentiable and continuous function. But its converse is not true. What this statement says. In fact, if the function is an entire function, definitely such function will be analytic, differentiable, and continuous. But if you say that there is a function, let us say f of z, which is continuous, differentiable, or analytic, then it may or may not be an entire function. An entire function, it may or may not be. We can say that f of z is analytic. F of z is analytic. Differentiable too, continuous too. But remember, the entire function seizes its analyticity at z equal to infinity. In fact, if f of z is analytic everywhere in a complex plane, even then f of z will be not analytic at z equal to infinity. At, or in other words, you may say z equal to, you may say mod of z, that may be plus minus infinity both. This is in fact singular or singularity of an entire function. So remember, if the function is analytic, it is differentiable and continuous, even then it may or may not be an entire function. But if the function is an entire function, definitely it will be analytic, it will be continuous, and it will be differentiable. This is one of the remarkable fact. Now I would like to write down first the second remarkable fact, which you must understand, that an analytic function is always differentiable and continuous. Differentiable and continuous. If the function is analytic, guaranteedly the function will be differentiable and continuous. But again, its converse is not true. What does it mean? It means if the function is differentiable and continuous, then the function may be analytic or it not may be analytic. But in a straightforward sense, if the function is analytic, you may say definitely that function will be differentiable and continuous. Now the third important fact says a differentiable function is always continuous. And again, converse is not true. Converse is not true. If the function is differentiable, definitely it will be continuous. But if the function is continuous, it may be differentiable or it may not be differentiable. These are the three important facts. You must keep these facts in your mind, and it will help you in a study of the ideas of functions of a complex variable. Now, I hope you have understand the definition. In short, I just repeat it. I have defined, in fact, three facts. First of all, the analytic function at a point. When you say f of z is analytic at a point z equal to z naught, it means f of z is not differentiable only at z equal to z naught, but at all those points which are in close neighborhood of z naught, it is also differentiable. Then you say that f of z is analytic at z equal to z naught. And if our function f of z is analytic at all points of a region or of a domain, in that condition you say f of z is analytic in that region or in that domain. And in case of entire function, the function f of z is analytic everywhere at all points of a complex plane. The only limit is that z modulus of z should be in fact less than infinity. In fact, when z mod of z is equal to infinity, the function does not remain function, but that becomes a constant. And so we say that the entire function has the singularity mod of z equal to infinity. And after that, I have stated the three important facts which you have just read. Now, I want to explain how we will test that a function f of z is analytic or not. This is in fact the most important idea which we have to discuss. How to test f of z is analytic or not. So this is the most important fact. How to test f of z is analytic or not. In fact, I just want to explore my ideas by giving some important examples which will clear the picture of analyticity of a function or analytic function. In fact, I would like to mention two techniques to test that the given function f of z is analytic or not. There are two techniques which I will discuss. The first one is known as the necessary and sufficient condition for f of z to be analytic. And that condition is also known as Cauchy-Riemann condition or Cauchy-Riemann equation. Cauchy-Riemann condition. Or equation. In fact, Cauchy-Riemann condition I will discuss in next lecture in vivid, but here I am just going to mention it, but not I will use in this lecture of this condition. This is one of the mathematical tool, or you may say the strongest mathematical tool to test the analyticity of a function. But in present lecture, I will give a very shortcut but intelligent technique to test the analyticity of a function f of z, But just for reference, I am mentioning Cauchy demand condition here, but its explanation will be found in my next lecture. In fact, what is Cauchy Riemann condition? What does it say? We know the function of a complex variable W, which is in fact function of a complex variable W, and this equal to U of X and Y plus I V of X comma Y. Here U and V are the real and imaginary part of the function of a complex variable F of Z or W. In fact, F of Z or W is called an analytic function. What is the necessary condition for F of Z to be analytic? The Cauchy-Riemann condition says, for F of Z to be analytic, there must be the partial derivatives of U and V, that is real and imaginary parts of this F of Z, must exist in the whole region R. That is, you may say, number one, del U del X, del U del Y, del V del X, and del V del Y must be continuous in R at all points. And the second condition is in fact Cauchy-Riemann condition. This states del U del X must be equal to del V del Y and del U del Y must be equal to minus del V del X. In fact, this condition is known as Cauchy-Riemann condition. These are CR condition. Function F of Z will be analytic when these conditions get satisfied. So in a problem, when we are given a function F of Z and we have to test its analyticity, that is the function F, the given function F of Z is analytic or not, we test these conditions. We find these partial, four partial derivatives, and see that these conditions are satisfied or not. If these conditions are satisfied, we say that the given function is analytic. But as I have told you, I am not giving the detailed analysis of this, because I will discuss this Cauchy-Riemann condition in my next lecture independently, where I will derive it and also discuss its utility to test the analyticity of a given function. In fact, here my aim is to explore a very simple technique. This is a very simple technique. You can solve a problem in an objective manner without any without following large steps. You can just observe the problem and say you will be able to say that the given function is analytic or not. So I am just giving a very short but a intelligent method to test the analyticity of the given function F of Z to be analytic. It is either analytic or not. So let us see how I will test that the given function is analytic or not. Sort technique. In several exams, objective questions are asked, and if you will take these things which I would like to explain in this lecture in your brain, you will be able to directly answer the question without solving the problem with exact steps. So let us see the our function of a complex variable f of z, which is a function of z, and z is what? Z is equal to x plus I1. See here, in fact, x and y in this combination are independent from one another. These are independent, or you may say linearly independent of one another. And what will be then its complex conjugate, that is z star will be x minus I1. Remember one thing, f of z is analytic only when f of z is analytic only when x and y has a combination like x plus I1. If x and y has a combination of x plus I1, only then f of z will be analytic. What does it mean? It means if x and y has a combination of x minus I1 or any other combination, then definitely f of z will be not an analytic function. You may say in guaranteed way that f of z is analytic only when these independent variables x and y are combined in this manner, that is x plus I1. It means z must have a real part and it must have an imaginary part, and between these two parts there must be a sign of plus, not of minus. It means if z has a combination of x minus i, that is of z star, then f of z cannot be analytic. This is a most important fact. Remember it. When we have to test the analyticity, we should take this idea in our brain, and we can say directly that a given function f of z is analytic or not. When I will give some example, it will be clear to you. One thing here you must remember, that x and y are linearly independent from one another, and f of z is analytic only when these two independent variables has a combination of like x plus iy. If the combination is like x minus iy, f of z cannot be analytic. What does it mean? It means if an expression contains z star, that is the complex conjugate of z, definitely that function will be not an analytic function. So one thing remember here, if f of z contains z star, then it cannot be an entire function or analytic function See, a simple technique, we see that the given function contains the factor z star, that is complex conjugate of z, or not. If it does not contain z star, it will be an entire function. But if it contains z star, guaranteedly it will be not an entire function or an analytic function. Let us see some of the important examples here. We can see in a very easy manner. See, z equal to x plus iy. And z star equal to x minus iy. Let us see a very simple algebra. If we have to find x in terms of z and z star, what we will do? Simply add these two equations, you will get 2x equal to z plus z star. And so what will be x? X is simply z plus z star over 2. Similarly, if we want to find y, let us subtract z star from z, and you will get y. And what will be the result? Y will be in fact z minus z star over 2i. Now, I would like to ask you a question, that you say x is analytic or entire function or not, and similarly y is an analytic function or an entire function or not. My question is x an entire function? And if it is entire function, yeah, as you have seen, that definitely it will be analytic. So there is no need to say it is an analytic. If the function is entire function, as in the above three facts, the first fact says, if the function is entire, definitely it is analytic. So I am not repeating the word analytic, but just write entire function. If is x an entire function? My question is an entire function? You may answer this question in a very short manner without any calculation. As I have stated above, if the expression for the given function, here f is in fact x, and the expression for x, let us see here, contains the factor z star. And what I have told you above, if the function f contains the factor z star, definitely such a function will be not an entire function. And if it is not an entire function, it is not an analytic function. F equal to x as x contains z star, f contains z star, so it is not an entire function. I hope everything have been clear to you. Similarly, let us see, if I ask you, is y an entire function? What will be your answer? Definitely you will say no. Why? Because you see here, the expression for y also contains z star. And so, definitely I can say that y is not an entire function. And if it is not an entire function, then it is not analytic too. Now, let us take some other example. As we have seen in the first lecture, there were three representations of the complex variable z. The exponential representation, in exponential representation, I have represented z as r into e to the power I theta. Here, in fact, r and theta, these are in fact the polar coordinates. And if we have to test these r and theta are entire function or not, how I will test it? So number A is r an entire function? Let us test it. As we know, how R is defined, mod of R is in fact defined as x square plus y square whole to the power half. And as you know, x square plus y square, this is in fact what? This is z into z star and to the power half. See here, the expression for z again contains the factor z star. And so you can say that r is not an entire function as it contains z star. This implies not and entire function. R is not an entire function. In fact, in another manner we can also say it as R has only a real part, no imaginary part. But for a function to be analytic, there must be both of the parts, real and imaginary. Since R has only real part, no imaginary part, so this function cannot be analytic. Now let us see about theta. Theta is entire function or not? Entire function or not? We have to test. In fact, what is theta? Theta is, in fact, as you know, this is in fact tan inverse y over x. And in as you have seen above, I have defined y and x in terms of z and z star. So substituting the values of y and x in terms of z and z star and making some simple algebra, you will get the expression for theta is 1 over 2i ln z over z star. Z over z star. What you see here? The expression for theta contains the factor z star, and so definitely theta is not an entire function. This implies not an entire function. Theta is not an entire function. So till now we have seen some examples which are not entire functions. Now I will give some important examples where you will find that the given function is an entire function, and since the functions will be entire, so definitely that will be analytic. Let us take a very important example. Let us see. This is in fact third example. Let us consider z is an entire function or not? Z is an entire function or not? Definitely yes. Yes. An entire function. Entire function. Because this is in fact x plus iy, it has both a real and imaginary part, and in this expression there is no z star, so definitely z will be an entire function, and Cauchy-Riemann condition will be satisfied if you work out the algebra, which I have said that I will deal this in next lecture. Just like that, if I say z square is entire function or not, answer will be yes. Yes, it is an entire function. How? Because z square does not involve z star. When you say z square, if you say modulus of z square, that includes in fact z star, but z square means z into z, and so it does not contain Z star, and so this implies it is an entire function. Now, in fact, in more general form, let us take an example z to the power n, where in fact z to the power n, where n is positive integers, just like z to the power 1, z square, and in general z to the power n. This is, you may also say it, a monomial. This is in fact yes means it is an entire function. Because it does not contain Z star. Let us say a polynomial Pn of Z, which is a polynomial. And this will be expressed as a power series in Z, only Z, not Z star. So the answer will be yes, it is an entire function. Now see one most important example, and from that example we will understand several things. Most important example is, in next example we will consider the exponential function, that is number 6, e to the power z is either an entire function or not. We have to test. You can see very easily from the definition of e to the power z, we know that e to the power z has a definition in power series. How e to the power z is defined? It is defined as 1 plus z plus z square over factorial 2 plus so on. And in brief, you may write it, this is summation n 0 to infinity z to the power n over factorial n for all finite z. You see here, e to the power z is defined as a power series in z. And does this expression contains z star? Definitely not. You see here, this expression contains only z or different powers of z. So we can easily say that as e to the power z does not contain z star, so it is an entire function. So this will be an entire function. E to the power z is an entire function. A very important example which will come in our discussion in so many times. Now let us see some combination of e to the power z. You know that cos hyperbolic z, how it is defined? It is defined as e to the power z plus e to the power minus z over 2. And as e to the power z and e to the power minus z both are in fact entire function, so cos hyperbolic z will be also an entire function. And if it is entire function, it is analytic too. Again, sine hyperbolic z, this is in fact e to the power z minus e to the power minus z over 2. Just same argument, you may say this is an entire function. So cos hyperbolic z, sine hyperbolic z, both are entire function. Let us see some other examples of the exponential function. Number 8, you may say, how we define cos z? We define cos z as e to the power iz plus e to the power minus iz over 2. And here again z star is not present, and so you can say that it is an entire function. Similarly, sine z, how you define sine z? Sine z is defined as e to the power iz minus e to the power minus iz over 2i. And on the basis of same argument, you may say this is also an entire function. Now let us see an important example. Tan z. What you can say about tan z? Tan z is not like in fact sine z or cos z, because tan z is a discontinuous function. And so we will see later on by the rigorous calculation, but here I am just giving an insight that as tan z is a discontinuous function, so tan z is not an entire function. As I have told you that the condition of analyticity is very crucial, so if you not think seriously, the people think tan z is simply sine z over cos z, and so if these are analytic, then this should be analytic, but don't think in this straightforward manner, tan z is in fact not an entire function. Now, an important example, let us say f of z equal to 1 over z to the power n. It is not an entire function. Why? Because this function has singularity at z equal to 0. So this is all for this lecture, and in next lecture we will meet with the idea of Cauchy-Riemann condition.